This is Neil Jones joining me on the show tonight. They are legends. We love them. Skid Row, we're speaking to Rachel Bolan. How are you, sir?
I'm doing well, man. I'm doing well. Thanks for having me.
I never know if it's Bolan or Bolan. It's Bolan, isn't it?
Bolan, yeah, yeah.
Bolan.
It sounds so much classier with a British accent, too. So.
Well, listen, we were just saying there before we started the interview, you guys have been like sick as dogs on the road. Just tell us about it. Loads of dates cancelled. How is everyone doing?
Everyone's getting there. I was one of the first ones to get sick, and it was just one of those things. It was a short run. It was the third leg of the Skid Row Buck Cherry tour, and you know, it's just one of those things. You're on a tour bus, and one guy gets sick, and it just runs like wildfire. You know, I woke up, and you know, when you wake up, and you're like, I'm sick. I have something. And I tried to tough it out and first thought it was a flu, then ended up with COVID. And then a couple other guys got the flu. And when it started spreading like really fast to our crew and stuff, we're like, well, we need to reschedule shows. So this band just needs a break. We got to hit a hard restart for 2024.
I mean, you're kind of road dogs. You've been doing this such a long time. I gather, did Snake have some back surgery at one point as well, or was it his neck?
Yeah. Early this year, I believe. Yeah, he had two discs replaced, and he's doing fine with that. But then he got sick on the road now. So,
and just while we, you know, not to dwell too much on sickness, but of course, Eric has got his well documented problems as well. He's had bone marrow stuff as well. How's he getting on?
He's good. He got a touch of the flu, I believe. I don't know whether he got COVID or the flu. I don't remember. But you know, we with him, we have to take extra precautions because of he's immunocompromised. So, you know, what could be the sniffles for you and I could turn out to be a really bad situation for him. So, you know, we have to take that into consideration. So we're like, you know what? There's shows. It sucks to have to reschedule because a lot of people, you know, made plans around it, but you got to do, health has to come first.
Well, listen, there's something here in the UK that when you get a cold, it's called a hot toddy and it's like a whiskey, right? You know, and it just knocks you. So that leads nicely onto something that Skid Row have got involved in with some Skid Row booze. I'm loving this. We've got Midnight Vodka and we've got 18 in Life Rum. This is a kind of partnership with Brand for Fans, isn't it? Tell us about when you got approached about that. What was the band's thoughts?
Well, it was a while ago, and I think it came through Eric because he's Swedish, and they're Sweden based, and we're like, cool, this could be fun, you know. We're very protective about our brand, so we didn't want to just, yeah, sure, put our name on the label, let's go. So it was like about a year, probably a little more than a year in the making. We met with them when we played in Sweden, in Stockholm, and we started with the taste test, which is really fun, I must admit. So, you know, those of us in the band that drank, which is Rob, Snake, and myself, and we were test tasting, and Rob Hammersmith is actually the rum guy. So we're like, okay, what do you think of this? And what do you think of that? And so we kind of based it off of his opinion on that, where we all, the three of us drink vodka. So we were really meticulous about everything, and starting with the taste and then moving on to what shape of bottle, and then the marketing plan and the design on the label. So we're very involved with it. Like I said, it's not something we're just like, oh, here's our name, put it on a label, sell, you know?
Yeah.
Because we don't want to do that. We don't want to put out a product that everyone's going to, I mean, I'm sure not everyone's going to like it, because liquor is an acquired taste regardless. Some people don't like vodka. Some people don't like rum, you know, but I have to say, not being a rum drinker, I really, really like the rum, this 18 and Life rum, and the Midnight Vodka is outstanding. It's great. We had samples sent out. So on the bus, we had Bloody Mary Day, and you know, so it's good stuff. And it's something like it's, I love to create, and it was just another avenue to create, you know, and being able to ingest it makes it even that much better.
If you don't like the 20-year-old you, you know, you ever could have fast forwarded and see that one day you'd have your own band Vodka, you'd have probably thought the world had gone mad, right?
Yeah, oh, absolutely. I mean, man, when I was 20 years old, there wasn't, you know, artists supported anything like this. You know, there wasn't coffee, there wasn't hot sauce, and then somebody got the great idea one day to do this. And it's, you know, those who really care about their brand and put out quality products, man, it's a really cool way just to keep another level of contact with the people that listen to your band, you know.
Basically, it's all Gene Simmons' fault at the end of the day, isn't it?
Yeah, let's blame it on him.
I mean, the KISS logo is on everything, isn't it? You know,
I don't see any Skid Row coffins coming up anytime soon.
My favorite quote from Gene, we had him on the show many years ago. He said, we've got KISS condoms and we've got KISS caskets. We get them coming and going.
No.
Well, listen, I remember my last Skid Row gig was the one that was being filmed in London for a DVD. Is that DVD actually come out yet? Or what's the plans with that?
It hasn't. We've been we're in editing, the last little bit of editing. We're hoping to have it out by springtime. Again, very protective of the brand. We don't want, you know, if it's a little shot that someone doesn't like, then we take it out and replace it with something else. So yeah. We're just at the point where the finishing touches are being put on the mix and on the video editing.
Awesome.
So hopefully,
and will that serve as a bridge to what will, I guess, be the follow-up to The Gang's All Here? You'll then start to think about a brand new album?
Yeah, I mean, I've been writing. I know Snake has a bunch of ideas. Scotty had a bunch. You know, we call them soundcheck riffs. We've been just trying different stuff at soundcheck. And so, yeah, that's the plan, hopefully, is to put out another album not too long after the live record comes out.
What happens for you guys over Christmas and New Year then? Downtime?
Yeah, we're off until March.
Wow.
So I'm just, you know, I during... Since October, I've been moving. I've moved back to New Jersey, and the house is for sale down in Nashville. So it's just like, it's so, my life is so chaotic at this point because we're staying in a house that we have bought. It's just we call them shore houses. So it's a small house near the ocean and whatever. And, you know, we're trying to fit 8 years of stuff in a much bigger house into this tiny, anyway, you know. Silly problems to have, but yeah, so that's what I'm doing over the two month break. I got contractors coming in and out of the house and stuff like that, and I'll try to get in a little creativity in that meantime.
Busy times. I was going to say, what do you do on your downtime? What does Rachel Boland do when he's not writing or moving house or actually playing live?
I have my studio set up and I'm in there a lot. I drive people crazy. I drive Layla absolutely nuts. She's like, can you just calm down for 1 minute? I can't though. I don't, it's not in my wife. Like, I'm like, okay, I'm going to take today off. I'm going to chill. I said that this morning. I go, I have one interview and I go, I'm going to take the rest of the day off. And then I realized I just scheduled two more meetings after we're done. So it's like, you know, I'll take Christmas Day off, but then that's Christmas Day.
But that work ethic, I mean, you and Snake between you were the driving force, and Rob, of course, the driving force behind the band. That's served the band well over the years, that kind of work ethic, hasn't it?
Yeah, it really has. And that's actually what drew me into him, to, you know, to say, man, I want to work with this dude. Other than being a great player, his work ethic was just insane. Uh-oh, did I lose you? Oh, there you are.
No, no.
His work ethic was insane. And it was... I was like, wow, we have the same principles and stuff like that. So yeah, we work hard. We work really hard.
Just circling back to Eric, if I may, for a minute as well. I mean, he has become the fans' favorite. They absolutely love him as the singer in Skid Row. I think you found him, Rachel, was that right? You kind of stalked him on YouTube, maybe?
Well, Heat, his old band, opened up for us. They did a UK tour with us. And I just had my ear. When I was first approving the video spot for the tour, I was like, wow, this dude can sing. I like his range and stuff like that. I had no idea of his background, the Swedish Idol and all that stuff. I had no idea about that. I didn't know that actually until the tour was almost over. And I heard him. I was like, wow, he's got some pipes, you know? And I was thinking, maybe I'll do a side project with him. And it just never materialized. And then when he put out a cover of 18 and Life, then I found out about his leukemia and all that stuff. And he was recovering. And when we knew, we came to the point where we were going to make a change, I was like, let's call this guy. We don't know his situation. He might, it sounded to me as he got out, that he got out of the music business, but I'm not sure. And I just shot him a DM on Instagram, and he answered back, and we talked a bit, and then we got on a Zoom and all that, and here we are.
And the songs were, of course, were already written, weren't they? They were good to go, yep. Those songs, yeah.
Yep, they were written, and they had a lot of guide vocals on them where we just sent it to him, and we're like, do your thing. And our producer, Nick, was also saying, here, hold this note longer, scream here, do this, and then just a lot of back and forth.
Yeah.
And here we are.
His range is phenomenal. Well, listen, a couple of quick final questions. You mentioned the word side project there, which leads me nicely onto, I've always wanted to ask you this question, Rachel. Prunella Scales. It's such, I mean, there's British people who don't get the reference, but Americans, I was really intrigued as to why you ended up with that name for your side project band.
Okay, so Elwood, who is a guitar player, one of the guitar players, he was actually, at the time, he was my guitar tech, and we were really good friends, and we were both into punk rock and just had a lot of the same musical taste. And when we were touring Europe, we just went on a Fawlty Towers binge the whole 5 weeks we were over there, because they had every DVD, and we just watch them every day. And we knew we were putting together a project. We're like, what are we going to call it? And we went through a few names. And then the credits started rolling. I go, it would just make so much sense to call this Prunella Scales. I don't know what the legal ramifications will be, but let's just do it. And it was originally called Prunella Scales Psychotic Episode, but we figured that was a little. We're basing that on we're basing that on the Kipper episode where she was flipping out, and we're like, let's just call it Prunella Scales and let's see what happens.
It is certainly memorable, that is for sure.
Right on. We talk, you know, he plays bass now for ZZ Top.
Oh, it's the same Elwood, right? Okay, yeah.
And because he, from after Prunella Scales, at the time he started working with Billy, and then after Dusty passed, they made him bass player, but we still keep in touch. We always talk about him, Tommy and myself. We're like, we got to do another Prunella record, man.
And that beard of his is real, right? Is it?
What's that?
The beard is real. Elwood's beard. Yeah.
For real. Yeah.
I mean, you can't be in ZZ Top without a beard, unless you're Frank, of course, you know, you've got it. It's kind of... Well, listen, we'll wrap up. We'll play a track from, we'll probably play the title track, I think, featuring the awesome vocals of Eric. Listen, have an amazing Christmas. We can't wait to see it. When do you think, if you were to take a guess, roughly which year, which month might you be back in the UK, do you think?
Oh, man, I don't know. I really don't know. We're trying to put, we're trying to schedule our 2024 right now. It's been a little harder to do. We got to schedule around doctor visits and stuff like that, which is what we're going to do. You know, it's the way things are, and we have no problem with that. So, for Eric. And so we're just trying to plan out everything, and it takes a bigger blueprint nowadays, but
yeah.
So you guys will know. I wish I could give you a date, man. I really wish I could, because we love the UK and we know it's our home away from home.
Well, listen, you filmed your new DVD in London, so we're looking forward to seeing that one. Well, listen, whatever those dates are, we will all be there down the front. And listen, Rachel, an absolute pleasure catching up here. We wish you health and happiness, with the emphasis on health this time around, I think, as well.
And well, have a great holiday, dude.